So I have been using Maya for 15 years or so, maybe. So I am obviously biased because Maya is the software, my go-to software that I've been learning and using from the very beginning of my career. Obviously, there's other software out there that is incredibly powerful. I'm not trying to actually kind of talk bad about any of the software or saying anything. I just want to give you guys facts and experience, personal experience, based on Maya and Autodesk and where things are, the state of the industry right now. First and foremost, a major shout out to AnimState, a website about animation. They actually did a survey with about 400 professionals, developers in the industry. And some of the questions they were asked is basically like, how do you actually go about work? And what's your workflow? And what kind of software do you use the most? So out of 400 developers, 86% of them were using Maya. 39% use Motion Builder, which is also from Autodesk. 18% use 3D Max, and only 9% use Blender. Once again, major shout out to all the other software that is actually kind of a small but very useful, especially the ones that are free, because I think that is incredibly powerful for every animator out there. They cannot pay for a license right now. If you're actually a newcomer, if you're just starting to animate, obviously it comes across as perhaps maybe Maya is the default because they have been here for a long time, therefore is what people use all the time. But that is not really the reality of it. I come from a time that Maya used to belong to a company called Alias Wavefront. And at that point in time, Maya and 3D Max, which was the competing software, were pretty much tete-a-tete, right? And the reason why was because film was mainly using Maya and games were using 3D Max. The reason why Maya started to be used in games much more was exactly for the reason why film has been using Maya for so long. And that is because Maya is very flexible when it comes to basically write your own scripts in your own tools and your own pipeline and just like start plugging it in into Maya and use this one software to unite them all, and it works flawlessly. So from your perspective, let's say a individual user that is doing animation at home or rendering or whatever it is with Maya, Maya seems very complex. Obviously you have renderers, you have like cloth and fur and animation and graph editor, but a studio we'll see Maya as just a simple tool that they can actually then enhance. So for example, for games, you have artists working in Maya, creating objects for the world. Lighting sometimes will also use Maya to actually light up a scene. So that's another thing. Animators use Maya as well. So there's quite a lot of people, hundreds of people sometimes, working with one piece of software. If Maya was simple and bare bones as it comes out of the package, it would not work for a lot of people to communicate with each other. So this is why you actually have to have a way to connect all these other departments into one umbrella, hence why workflows, right? And pipelines. So you have to actually have ways that you can share. If an artist does a model, then you can actually get that model into Maya and start rigging. And the animator can actually get that rig and start animating and export them all to a place that then you can actually start putting it in game. So it becomes very flexible. And having Maya kind of being that wrapper that kind of unites things is incredibly powerful, especially when you have a lot of unknown factors in games, like an engine and how to implement an engine. And an engine, as good as they are, they're not as flexible as Maya is. And there's no other software out there in the industry that can actually do that. Like, I know, for example, that Disney has their own whole pipeline for animation, and Maya, from what I'm told, doesn't even look like the regular Maya. It's like their own tools, completely different. And I have worked in studios that their Maya looks incredibly different, mainly because, and I'm not saying like the UI looks different, because Maya looks like Maya anywhere you go to, but the amount of things you can do, export character pickers, the inside, the renderer, all of that stuff can actually be modified to actually work in a way that Maya doesn't do it by default. And then second best is Motion Builder, because the one thing that Maya doesn't do super well is motion capture. And it's not that you cannot import motion capture into Maya, you can do that. It's just like crunching all that animation data into Maya is normally not the best. Motion Builder is better when you have many actors with a lot of data that you have to actually put together. but Maya can still do that. So this is how flexible Maya is. If you spend time, and there's tools out there, they do that right now. If you spend time to build a tool, they can actually crunch that mocap data and put it into Maya and make it like work with a nice rig that flows really, really well. Then you can actually make it work. So yeah, I hope this actually gives you a little bit more information about why Maya is used by everybody and why, even though perhaps you actually work in Blender or you work in any other software, it might be wise for you to learn Maya at some point. Maybe if you cannot afford it now, wait until later whenever you can become a professional. But definitely, because the industry uses it so wide and so much, you as an animator learning Maya the best you can, so when you sit on that seat, whenever you get hired, right, when you sit in that seat and start animating, you already know the software itself, you already know what buttons to push. The only thing you need to focus on is the animation, because there's always some learning process, right? Software is software and everyone can learn it, but there's always a few months that you have to learn the software, where things go, and to be comfortable with it. After that point, you're good to go. Now, this is why we're doing this series, right? The animation power tips. So on the next one, on the next episode, I'll be talking about layers and how I use them and the basics of layers and how I actually go about thinking about layers when I'm animating professionally. So that's all I had for you guys in this episode. As always, stay well, stay safe. Peace.